The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at wrestlingwithjonas.com.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. God, that sounded really professional. Now I'm unprofessional straight away. I am your host, Billy, as always. And I am joined in this edition by 100% Scottish beef himself, the enforcer, Bobby Roberts.
Pure Scottish beef. 100% pure Scottish beef.
It was
on T-shirts, Billy. Come on.
They say pure. Oh, I was going to mention your other T-shirt, but I can't mention that without swearing. So
there's a good few T-shirts you can't really mention. But hey ho.
Bob Roberts. How you doing?
How you doing, Billy? I'm great. Thanks for having me on. It's been a while actually since I've actually spoke to you properly.
It has. We'll get to that because it's a very awkward story for me anyway. I do actually have one of the T-shirts that we can't put out. I was going to wear it and I thought, no, I can't. It's the Arrive Stun.
Yes, leaf. Yes.
I can't wear that on this. if it was an audio podcast, then absolutely I would do it just to pop you a bit. No, I can't on YouTube. Yes, I'll get to the boring question that we usually ask first, but this has been a long time coming because you were actually one of my first interviews entirely.
I think so. Back a long time ago, back when it was just the question and answer kind of thing, like the first five questions, and that's when, oh god, that must have been 2012,
something like that. Not even that, your first audio interview, because we did it at Rock and Wrestle.
So we did. Was that Strathpever?
I think it was at the Ironworks. It could be Strathpever. We definitely did Strathpever tour as well. But I recorded it, got home, somehow didn't save it, and lost the interview forever. I did the same with Steve Robertson for Rock and Wrestle. He wasn't too pleased because it was supposed to be a way to integrate it into the Northeast, and I lost it.
That's right. Yeah.
So we finally got there. But this one should stay recording.
Yeah.
Hopefully, I have had bad luck with Zoom in the past. Our episode with Jason Hyde died 15 minutes in because my internet decided to cut off. And we lost half an interview with Ian Skinner, but fingers crossed. Anyway, boring question. How did you get into pro wrestling? What got you hooked?
Well, in the pro wrestling world, right, I'm 37, so I done a DDP and started really late. And was it 13th today? 17th?
17th.
In 13 days, I would have been wrestling 10 years. So I'm coming up in a decade of wrestling. But the way I look at me in wrestling is I watched wrestling when it was 1980s. I was born in 84. I started watching wrestling as long as I can remember. It was 89, 1990 was when I first started watching it properly. And it was on cable television at the time. I can still remember watching Razor Ramon taking on Ludwig Borga and Tatanka. I can go back and Sergeant Slaughter and Hulk Hogan. Wrestling actually got banned in my house because my little brother started crying when Sergeant Slaughter shoved a flare in Hulk Hogan's face. And then wrestling disappeared from my house. So my story is pretty similar to the way Ruby's was. And then started watching wrestling again when I hit high school. So the way I look at my life, it's evolved the same way as wrestling did. When I was at high school, it was 95 to 97. It was that kind of, oh, we're in first, second year, this is great. In my teen years, it became the Attitude Era and stuff like that. Obviously, being a huge Stone Cold Steve Austin fan from the get-go, from as soon as he walked into WWF at the time, right until now. And then obviously when I left school, PG era, that kind of thing, like everything about wrestling I was attracted to, whether it be the pantomime, the stories, the razzmatazz, and then I watched Beyond the Mat. Beyond the Mat changed my whole perception on wrestling. It wasn't just watching it on TV. I wanted to know everything about it. the backstage, how shows go together, how storylines are made, how things are produced, even further into the future, and how a story arc progresses. All of that stuff, I wanted to be part of it. And then the chance came to wrestle, go to training at Souls Wrestling School.
So I would say, like, before you started going to training or finding Source Wrestling School, you just wanted to be in the business, not necessarily doing the wrestling bit, just wanted to do something in it.
I wanted to be part of it in some way or another. I mean, I remember being at school and everybody had their own wee cliques at school, and I was always with the group that liked pro wrestling. Like, everybody loved pro wrestling, but they didn't like to admit it. It was a dirty little secret. And we had this wee group, and it's like, oh, they're the ones that like wrestlers, they're the ones that had the figures and playing WWF Warzone in the PlayStation, and they kind of shunned a wee bit. But then as you get older, you kind of realise, no, that this is kind of a good thing to be part of. And then when I turned 16, 17, I wanted to be part of wrestling. I wanted to start training at college. When I was 16, the college I went to, they'd done a wee bit of amateur wrestling and judo, so I got into that. Done that from maybe about 6 to 7 months before I got chucked out of college for stupidity, so to speak. And basically sat my hands for a good while. It was at the back of my head. Still watched wrestling, obviously, but didn't think anything of it. And went into the army, came out of the army, got married, had a couple of kids, and thought to myself, if I'm not going to do it now, I'm never going to do it. And I looked up the Souls Wrestling School. At the time when I originally looked it up, it was in Linwood, and where I'm based in Ayrshire, it's near impossible to get there in public transport. You're taking a train and two buses. But then it moved to Ibrox, and it was just a train. And at the time, a couple of my friends, we all decided we'd go up, jumped in the car, and April 30th, 2001, I walked into Souls, which was a very, very, it was a day I'll never forget, put it that way.
Well, we might delve a little bit further into that in a second, but I do remember when I was in school, so I'm 30, so we're not, we're probably about a generation in terms of school difference. Yeah.
I'm old, Billy, just admit it, I'm old.
No, okay. I was trying to say it in a nice way, but generation school terms, but I didn't have any wrestling friend. I had one friend who didn't admit to being a wrestling fan in school, so my friend group was just the weirdos, so I was lumped with them. So that's where I was. So yeah, I like to ask people about their first day or first time training, but when you come to Source, was there a bit of back and forth before you actually joined, or you were just like Source Wrestling?
I'd right, go on. Originally via email with Damo, Killian Dane, obviously, about 2 weeks prior, asking when the session was that I could join that would be best suited to myself, what I needed to bring, and where it basically was. That was roughly about it. But I was really excited, and I'd emailed him a few times, really stupidly, as a fan. And to be honest, I'd never been to a wrestling show before I started training, ever. Never been to one, because they weren't doing my way that often. Very, very rarely, I think. I tell a lie, I went to one, and it was at the Magnum, and Yokozuna was there. That was the only time I remember going to a wrestling show at the Magnum. But there was a wee bit of back and forth, basically just Damo telling me, turn up, bring water, bring a spare T-shirt, and just get stuck in. And from there, that was it. Like, walked in, I didn't recognise anybody apart from the two folk I was with, and Viper was there. And obviously, Viper being from the same town as myself, I kind of floated towards her to kind of speak to her a wee bit, because both with Coburnet seemed a natural kind of thing to do.
So how was that first session then? You said it was a bit...
Well, terrifying. I was really nervous at first, because when we got there, people were running late. So there was a lot of people kind of congregating outside the training school at the time. at that time, I took it upon myself to introduce myself to a lot of people that I didn't know. Stupidly introduced myself as my nickname. My nickname at school was Taz. And introduced myself as, "How you doing? My name's Robert, but my mates call me Taz." That got the most hated looks I've ever seen from anybody. And it was only until like about 6 months after I realised, yeah, now I know why they didn't like me doing that. That's where I met the majority of people that I would consider friends. Then once we got into training school, the ring wasn't up because they had a show the night before. So they'd obviously dropped the ring off, and I was straight in there because I'd never seen a ring, and I'd never seen a ring being built. I'd always thought to myself, how does this go together? Because it must be some certain way of doing it. Can it be just putting up four posts, some beams and some boards? It must be. So I get straight stuck in about that because I thought that's what needed to get done. We get the ring up and built. I watched carefully how it was done, and I still hadn't a clue, like 2 years later, how it was done right. The ring we used to use, we called it Old Betsy. And it took a physics degree to actually kind of put it together and make sure all the boards aligned. And it was Craig Byers, who was brilliant at it. He could know just by looking at an angle how much a beam or a board was off. It was amazing. The first session, though, was took by Paul Tracy. And I had no idea who Paul was when I started training. I knew that he was big in Japan. Obviously, he was Fergal Devitt's tag partner. Other than that, I knew nothing of it. And at that point, I just finished playing roughly about 13 years of Sunday League football. So I'm thinking to myself, I'm not too bad. I'm quite fit. I played defence, so I was constantly running. This should be okay. And no, not at all. The biggest thing I take away from that was doing 256 squats in a row without stopping that. And I still maintain to this day, I couldn't walk for 2 weeks after that. It was a lot of cardio, a lot of calisthenics, a lot of movement just to start. And I was in the ring at this point, and he says, right, I want to see people rolling and taking a back bump. So I'd done a couple of forward rolls. And obviously, Paul, not knowing I'm completely brand new, I'm just, when he said back bump, I just went, I'm new. And he sent me out the ring to go with the other brand new trainees and go, yeah, you're over there. And then I started doing basic manoeuvres with Damo, Scotty Rennick, Nicky Storm, and Jayla Dark. And the rest of that, I loved every minute of it. Afterwards, I was sore as hell. Oh my God, sore as hell. But it opened up a completely different perspective of watching wrestling. As soon as I went home, turned on SmackDown, and I could see what they were doing in a completely different light. And it made me appreciate every single thing.
I think my knees just gave out just at the thought, 256 squats. My legs just went, snap.
I still remember the number, and it's ingrained in my head. And I say this to this day to trainees, they come through the door and say they do 50 squats and they complain about it, and they know nothing. They know nothing of actual pain.
Was there a part of you thinking, I could do four more just to get the round number? But, or was it just that was it? You were dead at that point?
It was more of a case of dropping out. It was like you keep going until you dropped out, and I had to. I had no choice. I wasn't even getting all the way down. I'm like, nope. For my own knees, I have to sit this one out.
So that's that whole new perspective thing. I've been finding that recently because I've been jumping into some free seminars. I've been invited to have a look and what have you. Still don't know why, because I'm just a blogger at the end of the day. But when I check these things out and to get the advice, you watch wrestling afterwards and go, oh, okay, they're doing that. They're doing this, yeah. And stuff you never think about until you actually hear someone who's done it go, oh, you need to do this, because if you don't do that, then this all won't work. You know, like,
yeah,
there's more science to it than you think.
Yeah, the psychology of wrestling got me more than anything else. Why things are the way they are and doing things a certain way makes sense. And there's so many gateways and paths to one thing, and it'll just branch off into 20 different things what it could and couldn't be. That still makes me, that keeps me in wrestling, because there's still opportunities to keep learning.
Absolutely, and especially with the I mean, even where we're in lockdown right now, there is always opportunities to learn, thankfully, because of stuff like this, like Zoom, yeah, and all that stuff. So how long was it before you made your debut in the ring?
So I'd spoke with Damo about when wrestling was going to go back to Ayrshire, because I'd not long done a tour of Ayrshire when they'd done West Kilbride, Beath, and I think Idrossan, maybe Stevenson at one point, about a year previously, and they weren't sure about going back, but they were going to do Beath. Now, where I'm from, I stay in Kilburn, and Beath is literally the next town over. So I was getting billed as being from Beath. So Damo told me November 18th is when we're going to be in Beath. I says, I want to try and make that. I want to be on that show. Like, I really want to be on that show. From April 30th to November 18th isn't a long time. And I said, I want to be in that show. He says, well, you need to prove it. So I was in the training school sometimes 4 days a week for 4 hours at a time, doing private sessions. That, like, literally, I sacrificed a lot. Like, time with my kids, time with my wife, money, just to make sure I could make that show. And I don't regret none of it. It was one of the best experiences of my life. Like, we'd done the Beath Community Centre. I remember there was 165 people in there. I was on first half main against Glenn Dunbar. And honestly, it's still online. My debut's still online. Somebody recorded it on their phone. And it is, watching it back is so cringy, but then I still see parts of it that I still do now. And it kind of makes me happy.
And if there's anyone that you want to debut with, from what I've heard and read, it's, yeah, Glenn Dunbar.
Oh, Glenn Dunbar can make a plank. I would look good. Honestly, at the time, I was so nervous, and a muscle went over the match about 10, maybe 20 times backstage, like pulling up Glenn, going, right, is this bit, blah, 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 blah. So, and we do it there, and he made me look fantastic, and I can't thank him enough for that. And ever since then, me and Mikey have had a great, we've had a great relationship. We've wrestled each other so many times. We trust each other so much. We wrestled in Largs, we wrestled in Helensburgh, and it was basically, right, what are we doing? All right, we'll do it there, no bother. And every match I've had with him has been pretty great. No complaints whatsoever.
Yeah, like I said, it's every time I mention, especially if someone from Source, Glenn Dunbar always pops up, either as an advice giver, or it's, yeah, likely their first or second match. Just because it popped into my head, I was speaking about Craig Byers having the eye for the ring. I mean, that's what I expect from a teacher, to have it leveled.
Definitely, it's like you need a physics degree just to put the ring together. At some points, especially old Betsy was a spring-mounted ring, and it had to be certain ways, and things had to be in certain positions, and you could just look at it and go, no, that needs to move. Like, I can now do it with my ring sitting there, and I can look at it and go, no, that needs to move slightly to the left and up a wee bit, and it makes it perfect. So it's Craig Byers who, like, kind of taught me the majority of building that ring just by watching him. Same with Lewis Garvin and Christopher Saint as well, like the ones that came before me. Watching them, I take a lot of pride in building rings. I don't know why, I just do. You've got to make sure your stage is perfect to perform on.
Absolutely, I mean, and obviously safe, because one wrong, exactly. one board in the wrong place, that's, yeah, game over.
Well, tell me about it. I've been in a few rings that I've just weren't safe, so to speak. And that's it. It could just be one board moved slightly the wrong way, or one beam, and it could just go. I mean, I've been on shows where I've been ring crew, and one of the beams has popped out completely, and we've had to try fix it mid-match. It's just these kind of things that happen, but it's knowing how to fix it, the main thing.
So I won't make this a podcast all about rings, but just before we move forward, I saw when Rock and Wrestle were doing shows, I saw them build the ring, and I was with my girlfriend at the time, now wife, And I think she got an appreciation of wrestling more seeing a ring. Because when you see it, it's like, oh, it's padded. Oh, they've got big pads. They'll be absolutely fine. And then you see it getting built, it's that. That is your padding. That is it.
Depending on the ring, to be fair, like, I've been in rings and there's next to no padding on it to rings that are like, they've got about 3 inches worth of a mattress on it. And sometimes they're worse than having no padding at all because your ankle could slip. And you just, it's no good.
Right, so we'll move away from the ring chat.
I do have a funny thing though. When I was at Source, just before I left Source, they had like some of our trainees had this in joke of basically you had to graduate from the Bobby Roberts School of Ring Building, and it was basically a complete and utter rip on me because I'd automatically try and take charge of the situation, going, that needs to go there, blah, 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 blah. And people would get really annoyed by it. So they made up the Bobby Roberts School of Ring Building.
So what I've got so far, we've only got to your first match, is
God.
You're a bit keen. Yes. Whether it was a good or a bad thing, you were keen.
Very, very keen. Very, very, very keen. Like, I was constantly annoying everybody running up to my debut when I was selling tickets. Previously, before I'd obviously started wrestling, my main job was in sales. I was a salesperson, and I was an aggressive salesperson. I pride myself on the fact I can sell ice to an Eskimo if I tried. It's one of my main things when promoting respect as well, is I'm very, very sales-driven. So when I'm trying to promote my character for a show, especially for my debut, I'm pushing the show, I'm pushing my character, I'm saying you need to buy these tickets, and I'm literally waving them in their face. I even done it at ICW on my shirt when I was in character, like literally pointing it the shirt in somebody's face and shouting buy my shirt and gimmick, and magically it worked. But keen would be a complete understatement for when I was in my younger career. If that's a word.
I mean, it definitely shows that you're able to sell respect as well, which, again, I'll be we don't have a set timeline in this.
We'll jump, but
it shows that you do have that kind of salesman power, because respect of so many, like, you have so many sponsors, you have so many affiliates that you share their content with, so obviously it helps them, it helps you. Right, let's go back to 2011 then. You've had your first match. You said you had a bit of a football background, did Sunday football for 13 years beforehand. Obviously, you must be confident with the crowd because having a sales background as well, you have to be. Were you private Bobby Roberts when you first started, or was there a little bit of a teething point before you were?
It was a strange one. It was before I'd even debuted. They wanted me to tag with Ricky Gibson. And at that time, he was in the TA, in the Territorial Army, and he took on the gimmick of Private First Class Ricky Gibson. And I was, for some stupid reason, I used to wear camouflage trackies to training, don't know why, but they also found out that I was in the Army. So it kind of made sense to try to put us two together. And then when I was trying to think up a name, I was like, right, okay, there's not too many Bobbies in wrestling now. And then I was like, right, name. And then I came up with Bobby Roberts, obviously. And then we just put Private in front of it. At one point, for some weird reason, when I was tagging with Ricky in a draw, and I came out as the Lion Rampant Bobby Roberts, which was not my idea. Thank God it didn't stick. But the Private Bobby Roberts kind of stuck for a good while, and it did work, and I milked that military background something stupid. I mean, don't get me wrong, when I was in the Army, I was in the AGC, which is the Clerks Department, the Clerks Corps based down in Winchester, so I wasn't exactly out with rifles and stuff like that, but it was still military in the eyes of the pills that be that gave us gimmicks. So, I mean, it worked and I ran with it.
One of my favourite jokes, running jokes, it seems to be, whenever, I think it's Lewis Gervin, speaks about you, is that your name's Robert Roberts.
Yes.
Was that part of the thought? Or was it just like, Bobby Roberts, that's it, and don't think about it otherwise?
Nope. Like, originally when I got the idea, I was like, oh, that's, it rolls off the tongue. It's like Bobby Roll, and it works really well. And then about 3 weeks later, I'm thinking to myself, yeah, my name's Robert Roberts. It's like that. That's like, that's parental abuse. That is. That's. But at the same time, it's a kind of, it's a take on my own name. So it's who am I taking a rip out of? Myself. Oh, yeah. It works. It's just funny. Like even like during promos, Lewis would refer to me as Robert Roberts or Mr. Robert Roberts when we tagged down Alpha Omega.
I'm telling you, there's money in that if you decide to go all business suit.
If I go corporate,
Robert Roberts, that's boo material. That's booing all over
I don't
it.
Know.
Maybe one day, never know. Right, so I think I was there the day you promoted yourself to sergeant. I think that was Strathpeffer.
It was. It was actually, they didn't want to use private at the time because it was more synonymous when I was wrestling with SWA and Source. So Steve wanted me to call myself Sergeant Bobby Roberts. I'm like, okay, it doesn't make much of a difference to the gimmick. And then when I debuted that gimmick at ICW in one of the Square Goes, I was announced as Sergeant Bobby Roberts. And then in commentary, I was Sergeant Bobby Roberts. So I ran with it as much as I could. There wasn't much to it apart from just a name change. I didn't change the way I wrestled or anything like that. It was just a different name, and I wasn't too bald about it, to be fair. At that point, when it was Sergeant, it was kind of that point of my career, that gimmick was kind of just dwindling down, and I needed to reinvent myself.
I was right about that time as well. Again, saw stuff that I'm like flashbacking to what we discussed round about those shows, because I was driving you for one of them, for one of the shows.
That's right. Yeah, that's right. I remember. I was meant to be getting driven up in a car with a couple of the wrestlers that then couldn't make it. Then I had to get a bus. My first time ever having to travel via bus to a wrestling gig. And it was from Glasgow to Inverness, and it was phenomenal with no legroom. And then I phoned Steve asking where I was getting picked up, and you rolled up with Steve and Joey Legend.
Yeah, it's a weird day.
Yeah, and I'm like that. And I knew who Joey Legend was because obviously Mikey Whiplash spoke about him previously when Mikey was training at Source. And I thought, this guy wrestled in the WWE, and I got a wee bit starstruck. And he says, you can sit in the front. I'm like, no. You're the vet. You're in the front. He says, no, you can sit in the front. I'm like, okay. And I remember backstage at Strathpeffer, we got talking, and at this point I hadn't started. I did start doing the Stone Cold gimmick at that point, and we done the whole bit where Steve Austin came back at Unforgiven, I believe, in 2000. And he walked backstage and just called Just Your Sorry Ass Son of a Bitch and beat him up. And we'd done the whole skit backstage. It was amazing. It was honestly one of my top five moments of wrestling was doing that skit with Joey Legend.
Oh, amazing. And that was also around time you debuted your new gear. Because I remember this because it was the singlet with the camo down the sides.
That's right.
And round about the same time, a certain Big Show, Paul White, debuted the exact same gear.
Yeah, I was gutted, absolutely gutted, because then all my mates started calling me the Big Slow. And that stuck for a long time. And I loved that gear as well, because it was completely handmade. A lot of people don't realise, like, at the time, there was only a few people you could get ring gear from, and I'd messaged somebody down in England, M2M Wrestling, who are still used to this day, and that shield and all the lettering is actually hand-stitched on. I still have, in fact, it's in my drawer over there. And sometimes I do wear it, just sometimes, because it's actually still really comfortable. But my new ring gear is, I'm really, really happy with my new ring gear. But that's yet to be debuted.
But I just remember, again, this is all stuff we were speaking about at the time, but I do remember you going, I can't believe it. I can't believe Big Show's come out with this exact same stuff. So you mentioned Alpha Omega Wrestling, of course, outside of Scotland, this is one of the main places you were, Morecambe Wrestling and Alpha Omega, as part of the referendum.
Love that gimmick. Some say it wasn't a gimmick, but I was honestly, it was a great time working for Alpha Omega. At the time, it was paid promotions and then turned into Alpha Omega, and it was absolutely fantastic. The camaraderie backstage with the Scots was great. Absolutely, it was brilliant. Like myself, Ryan Grayson, Lewis, and whoever decided to kind of let's go with it, because the promoter had a lot of trust in us, especially when it came to Showtime, because most of our stuff we done was ad-libbed completely. Like, we just kind of went with it because the promoter trusted us. I remember at one point, it was myself, Scott Rennick, Christopher Saint, and Lewis. In fact, no, Lewis wasn't there at the time. We were on the balcony at the Morecambe Winter Gardens throwing tea cakes, Scott Tunnock's tea cakes, at one of the matches. And I believe Viper was tagging with Isle of Dawn at the time, and we were shouting just randomly, going, Viper! And just having a great time while she's having a match, and stopping deed and waving. It was brilliant. There was one funny story. It was after Scotland beat England in the Kolkata Cup a wee while back, and we were making our entrance, as we found out, and we let the whole crowd know that Scotland have just beaten England, and the front row Morecambe crowd were always fantastic. They're so vocal because to them everything's still what it is. And we came out with rugby balls and bottles and cans of Iron Brew, and Viper threw the ball to Ryan Grayson at the time. Grayson decided to try drop punt it, and obviously a rugby ball will go anywhere, and it went straight into the face of one of the front row. Like, smack. Don't get me wrong, it was awful, and I could not stop laughing.
It's one of those we have to take a moment going, are they fine? Aye. Oh,
yeah.
I'll laugh at this now.
Yeah, oh my God. It was honestly some of the best times I've ever had in wrestling was doing it. Even just the car rides themselves, the journeys in the car down to Morecambe were brilliant. Last night, Let It Go, and me and Scotty singing it. And like even Scotty driving me home all the way to Coburnie after dropping people off, not getting home till 12, just chatting. Brilliant, honestly brilliant.
You said you navigated yourself to Viper or Piper Niven, yeah. Of course now. And that was like your first day. So was that just one of your closest friendships that you built? Because I don't often see you tag each other's stuff.
She's like my wee sister. Like, I love her a bit. She's kept me on the straight and narrow a lot of times in wrestling. A lot in that, and I've been there for her as well. Like, if she's needed me when she's been in Japan, phoning me like 2 a.m, I'll answer that phone regardless. I don't know why we gravitated towards each other so fast, but we've done everything together. We're inseparable. We were putting out posters to 11, 12 o'clock at night to make sure the Usher tour drew really well, or it didn't in some cases, just being there for me. Like, there's been no day in wrestling that has been there for me more than Viper.
And another strange, well, not strange friendship, but when I put out the context of this, it'll sound strange. Emily Hayden asked you about Unity and Rick James.
Oh, God. So, Unity is basically like a kind of off-screen stable, as she's probably known me. Myself, Big Benny, and Emily Hayden, and what was Christopher Satan at the time. I think it was the night before, we're sitting watching the Charlie Murphy Chronicles and the Dave Chappelle show and the Charlie Murphy Chronicles and obviously the Rick James story, and just everything about that just made us pop, something fierce, everything. So every single thing we said always ended with a Charlie Murphy or a Unity or F Your Couch or You'll know yourself. I know you've seen it, so I can't repeat too many of the lines. And then at one point, basically, we were all tagging down at full tilt, and we were announced as clan for some reason, but we kept on shouting, "We are unity," and throwing up our wee hand signals. And it's just a good wee family kind of unit. And I'd love for it to be on a show. I really would. I mean, if only I knew a promoter that had a show that would book that kind of thing.
I mean, we'll get to respect soon enough, and we can speak about that more. I've also written down that I remember at the time, about 3 years ago, you had a neck injury. Yes. That was kind of you done at that point. Was it in ring or?
It was in ring, and it was more on stupidity, to be fair. Like, I'd planned a match, and the end of the match involved me taking the flare toss through four steel chairs that were set up, and I stupidly didn't tuck my head fast enough and essentially spiked up from the top rope. I've seen the footage back once. I've still got the pictures on my phone. Didn't even know about it. That's the thing. Did not even know about it. I drove back from Wick on the Sunday. Monday, I was coaching dodgeball, as I normally do every Monday night. And on the Tuesday, I felt I need to go to hospital. I think I've broken my pinky. So, and my knee was really sore. So I drove down to A&E, and I explained to the woman at the triage what had happened, showed her a picture, and she goes, "Yeah, we need to x-ray you completely, not just your pinky or your knee." I was like, okay, cool. And so obviously, 2 hours go by, x-ray, blah, blah, blah. So I'm sitting there, and the nurse comes back, and another doctor says, "Yeah, so you fractured your pinky, you've kind of got a slight tear in your ACL, and you fractured your neck." I was like, "What?"
Well, not the injury, but the order that they put it in.
Yeah. And I'm like, what do you mean fractured your neck? She goes, well you've fractured your neck. How did you get here? I says, "I drove." They're like, "Well, you shouldn't have been able to." I says, "Well, I did." She said, "When did this happen?" I was like, Saturday night, I think. So they put me through a couple more x-rays and an MRI, and I found out that I'd fractured the C3 vertebrae in my neck, which is the one that's just below the ridge in your head. So they basically said at that point, "Yeah, you can't wrestle." I was like, okay. So that was like a gunshot to the chest. Like, that was an immediate stop to anything I was doing. I was building up some good momentum down in Alpha Omega. Elsewhere, I was getting more bookings through, which was great, and new companies. I think I had like 7 new companies booked up for that year alone. And then that happened. And then obviously, after that, I just crumbled. Like, massive amount of depression. But I still wanted to wrestle. I still wanted to. So
that accelerate respect.
Yes, completely. I mean, I'd unofficially started Respect in November 26, 2016, where I was asked by my local primary school to put on a wrestling show for them because they were closing. They were shutting down the primary school to build a super school, and they wanted something for everybody to remember. So I put on a show, sold it out, well, a month before the show. Myself, I main evented it. I had Viper on as well, who also went to the same primary school. It was a great show. So from that moment, like, I'd left Source in 2016 as well. So I said to myself, "No, I want to run shows. This is the next step for me. I need to do this because I knew at that time you wouldn't see wrestling in North Ayrshire for a long time. So ran that show, I got the bug for it, I was like, this is great, I want to do this again. I ran another show under the Respect banner that time in 2017, and from there it just went. But then obviously when I broke my neck, that put a massive halt on things because I hated being on a show that I couldn't perform on. Yeah, fair enough, I was guest GM and the announcer to save a bit of money, basically. I still wanted to wrestle. I still wanted to feel that bump. I still wanted to hear the crowd pop, like from doing something. And for that full year running shows where I had Scotland versus England on that show, I had so many different people that I wanted to work with and I couldn't do it. I was like, this is killing me. I need to get back in the ring. So I thought, right, okay, I'm gonna start the Respect Pro Training Center. I'd had a good couple of guys round about me at the time. So I thought, why not? I get the blessing. I say the blessing from a couple of other higher up wrestlers, so to speak, because there's nothing in North Ayrshire. I am the only training school in Ayrshire, plain and simple. And I remember April 1st, 2018, Respect Pro opened its doors. We had two trainees walk in, that was it. I'd set up the entire ring, full matted area, the lot, in the Laquinic Community Annex for two people to turn up. And from there, it just grew. I took part in that training session, and that was the first time I'd took part in any physical activity or rehab, proper rehab, since breaking my neck, and I lasted an hour, which was a lot better than what I thought I would, but I still couldn't put any strain on my neck. And actually, a lot of people don't know that I broke my neck on November 18th, 2017. And then on January 4th, I re-broke it in a car crash.
Jeez.
So I'd actually broken it twice within the space of not even 6 months. So that I would have been back a lot sooner if it wasn't for black ice, basically, so to speak.
I glossed, because it popped into my head about Respect, I glossed over, you said you did go into a depression. I don't want to, like I say, gloss over that, because it is an important thing to speak about, especially this day and age where talking about your mental health is important. I don't have the equipment to deal with that, but I think it's good that people have their stories to tell.
Yeah.
So you said you had your friendship with, you had a good people, a lot of people around you. You had Viper and what have you. Yeah. So how did you cope with your depression, and how did you work your way out of it, or work your way to a point of being okay?
I just at that time I couldn't really do much to help myself, so I wanted to help others. Even though I was still in my cast, I was still coaching dodgeball. I just had to be careful what I was doing. I'm very silly. I will still train during injuries. I will still wrestle during injuries. I'm very silly like that, because I want to give 110%. Whilst I was still injured with my neck, I was still working as a doorman, which I shouldn't have. I was still training away. As I said, I was training other people as much as I could. But I wanted to give people somewhere that they could express themselves and be themselves. And that's why the Respect Pro Training Center was actually born at that time. Like, obviously Viper was there. She helped me a bit. Bette Noir, Christopher Saint, Lewis Garvin, DCT. Scotty Rennick was there at the third or fourth session, I believe. He was down for a couple of them as well, just to give his kind of veteran knowledge over to some of the guys as well. So I was just wanting to give back what I'd taken, essentially. And that itself gave me more drive than anything else to try and get myself back in the ring.
So pretty much you didn't deal with your own stuff, but you wanted to make sure other people were getting their stuff dealt with. So a bit selfless.
I think making sure everybody else was okay. I mean, like, I get hammered by my wife and my close friends that I try to give other people first before I take, which I do quite a bit. I will admit that. I'd rather see everybody else happy than me. And that's the same when it comes to wrestling. I want everybody else to enjoy themselves. That's my sole purpose on this planet, is to make people smile. It says on my Facebook profile, I'm here to entertain, here people smile. Here to make people smile, and that's what I do.
It's not a bad way to. I mean, it's not a bad way to live and think about it. No. But as long as you keep yourself regulated as well, which is
definitely. I've only recently started doing that. Only recently, I had a really bad mental spell a couple of months back, and done some really silly things I really shouldn't have done. I went and got the help necessary that I needed, so I got a much better outlook on life just now. A lot more positivity. I'm happier than I've ever been, especially now coming up to reopening the school and reopening the gym and the community centre. There's so many things coming up in the next couple of weeks. Yeah, I'm going to be flooded out my head with all these things, but everything's a positive, and I'm happy it's happening.
So let's boost up that positivity then, and spoke about it with Ruby, was the Fake Lips Rise video. How did that come about?
Well, so as Ruby probably explained, she was good friends with Stuart Brenner's brother James, and I've known Stuart Brenner for God knows how long. He stayed about 5 doors along the road from my aunt, who stayed around the corner from me, and I grew up with him playing in his back garden and stuff like that. And it's just out of nowhere, he basically messaged going, "Look, I've got a band that's interested in doing something with wrestling. Could you guys help?" I'm like, yes, oh God, yes. I'd already filmed something for one of Stuart's music videos years ago, but the music video didn't go ahead, and he's always wanted to collab. Stuart Brenner was actually the guy that filmed my first ever promo, which is online, which is 4.5 minutes long. But he said, "Can we do this?" So, all right, cool. Well, why don't you guys get the guys to come down? Obviously, if you've got an idea of what you want to do, we can fill in the blanks. So they told us the premise of the video. Obviously, you've seen the video themselves. Like, they come in, they get ridiculed, and then they get healed as the big good guys at the end. But we said, if they want to do that, they need to come in and see what it's actually like to train, even if it's just for a couple of weeks. So we had them in for a couple of weeks, basically going over bumps, basic moves, basic techniques. Even doing the drill zone and the plyometrics, we made them squat. It's like, you're not just coming in and seeing, oh, this is great, we'll do this bit, we'll use do the hard work. It's like, no, you'll earn this. So we've done that. Obviously, with the venue we normally use, the Garnet Community Social Club, which is our home venue, essentially, they let us use there for free, which was brilliant. We set the ring up, and Stuart made that place look like mania. It was absolutely fantastic. The wee crowd we had was brilliant as well. And the finished product is great. Like, we are now going to be using the theme song, Rise, as our intro tunes to our shows. So highly recommend that, folks. Go on Spotify and download Rise by Fake Lips.
Perfect way to plug it as well. I was speaking to Ruby about it, but you're actually doing the in-ring stuff with DCT.
Yeah, that was great.
It looked like good fun. So a lot of changes. You spoke about a training school, so we'll get to that. There's been a lot of changes in the last year, due to things, anyone listening or knows, still know what's happened. And also, there's been a lockdown. But one of the names that you brought on recently was Looking Sharp.
Yes.
In there. So what's the team now? What is your training team?
The team as it stands just now is obviously myself. We brought in Krieger. And obviously Looking Sharp as well, and DCT. So Krieger and Lou we've basically got an affiliation with each other, like with Pro Wrestling Scotland, Pro Wrestling Innovation, Respect. They're all trying to look after each other with the help of Logan Storm as a mediator. With Krieger as well, bringing in his experience on Looking Sharp, he's travelled God knows everywhere. I'm pretty sure he's got a stamp for every country in his passport. So he brings in a vast wealth of knowledge and a unique way of explaining things in a different way that you can pick up. And I've learned a lot from Lou and a lot from Krieger as well, as they've learned a lot from me. DCT just brings absolutely everything to the table, whether it's production, backstage, characterisms, just drills. He's the whole package, honestly. Like, DCT brings Respect Pro together.
especially, I mean, I was thinking about all those names that you brought on board. They've all worked internationally. They work on the WWE Network. DCT, of course, was in Australia. And of course, there's a, you're all students of the game, but he started as a journalist.
Oh, aye.
With his journalistic integrity, so you see, he has the kind of gift of the gab in written form, whereas you guys are more spoken word as well. Yeah. So it's a good mix of guys. Of course, you had Jayla Dark in and out as well. She was there a bit as well. So you've certainly had many come through. Is there anyone that's already made it to shows through school? I mean, I know Ruby. Has
Ruby has sources a little bit. Sean Martin, Ruby, and Craig. Well, Big Benny. Big Benny. I wouldn't exactly say he was one of us to start with. He was the original Source graduate back in the day, and he debuted in a battle zone for a whole 12 seconds. And he'll complain about me saying that, but he does say he was reborn when he came to Respect. And then obviously he debuted again. Sean Martin is what a fantastic prospect, honestly. He is a pure student of wrestling. He knows far more than I do about wrestlers, so to speak. But he is definitely one for the future. And Ruby as well. Like Ruby is almost like a wee mini carbon copy of myself, which can be a bad thing. But she's working on more positive aspects of being a Roberts. Which is great. So, but there is definitely a few more coming through the ranks. Once we reopen, obviously, I've had so many messages from some of the trainees and previous trainees from other schools that left a long time ago. Have decided to come back and give it another try. So I'm really looking forward to that kind of challenge.
I mean, I suppose not to labour on the bad things, but with people leaving the wrestling business. It probably gives people confidence, think, right, okay, they're gone. I can probably give it an hour go. I've actually got Sean Martin coming up on the show. I'm speaking to him. Well, this interview will be out after I speak to him, but April 26th. So I think I've hit the Respect triple threat then, because Big Benny was in the first season of the show as well. So, Ruby Roberts is continuing the family name.
She's my legacy, as I once told her really drunk in Maggie Mays. I says, "You're my legacy," and kissed her in the head, and she busted crying. But I was really drunk when I said that, so
she was a good reason why she was crying. She was like, "Oh no,
I don't know, she maybe ran out of beer, I don't know." But no, I look at Ruby and I see a lot of myself. Like we both have the same condition, fibromyalgia. It's very rare in men to have it, and I was only diagnosed last two years ago with it. So, but I don't have it as severe as what she did. And Ruby was my wee project, almost big brother kind of style. Like I took her under my wing, and I made sure she was not so much protected, but I push her more than any other trainee I've got, because I hold her to such high regard, and she puts in 110% effort every time she's in without fail, and she's in more than anybody else. But to be fair, she also stays 5 minutes away from the place. So, I've got a lot of hope for Ruby.
And did she decide to take on the Roberts name, or was that something you gifted?
Oh no, that was me. That was me completely. Oh, I was like, you're Roberts. She was, what do you mean? I says, right, we'll figure out your first name, but you're a Roberts. So we end up coming up with Ruby Roberts, but we spell it with an I. And we end up taking the mic, saying Ruby Roberts, which is quite funny. But but the thing is, as well, she got a ring gear, and it's got Ruby in the side of it. She's only worn it once, and now she can't wear it because she's dropped a phenomenal amount of weight. So now it's just hanging off her. So I'm thinking, if I can peel off the Ruby side of it, I'm going to steal it. So
yeah, I have to speak to her about that, because she put up a before and after picture just before I spoke to her, and I was like, I wouldn't have guessed it was the same person as well with that. Unbelievable. So we'll go back to your ring names for a second. Private Sergeant, we've already covered. 100% pure Scottish beef. What was the reason for that one?
That was the Pride era, so to speak. That's when I was working Pride quite a lot. And I just, I don't know why it just came to me. I have no idea. And I thought it was more of, it was, do you know what it was? Sorry. So we'd done a seminar with Nick Dinsmore, Eugene at Source. And he said one thing that just turned my whole life around. You're not just a wrestler, you're a brand. You need to make, you need to sell yourself as a brand. And the sales in me just went, and I went, ah, right, okay, what can I use that is almost everyday kind of stuff? So 100% pure Scottish beef, and then you've got the logo, the wit t-shirt. It's things that people would use most days, if not every day. I used to be a butcher as well, so I'd see 100% pure Scottish beef everywhere, and I'm like, that would look great on a t-shirt. And then I started getting announced as 100% pure Scottish beef, Big Bobby Roberts at Pride, and it just went for there. I'd only really use it if I was a face, because it doesn't really stick as a heel. Never did. Never caught on.
Yeah, it's a bit more of a cockier thing. So yeah. I'm the most pure athlete, I suppose. Yeah. With that, of course, I couldn't do a podcast without speaking about Stone Cold Bobby Roberts.
Oh, please.
Because it was incredible. So here's what I've got information-wise about it. Okay. You're doing an impression of him backstage, of Stone Cold Steve Austin, of course, and Dallas didn't know about it. You're put in front of him, eyes closed, you did the impression, and then that was Stone Cold Bobby Roberts.
Pretty much. Also been an Austin fan for God knows how long. I've always done the impression, I've always tried to perfect it as much as I could. And I remember we were training one day and we were taking like 5-10 minutes in between, like going from drill to drill. And people were just promoing randomly. And I remember it might have been Joe Coffey, I'm not sure. Not Joe Hendry, sorry, had done an Austin impression. And I says, that's terrible. And let's hear yours then. And I just burst out with it and everybody just doped it. And I remember Damo at the back room goes, yeah, that was better, but get back in the ring and get more work done. So people kept asking me at points on the smaller shows, we're doing Pride, we're doing Source, and I'm doing the impression backstage for people just to hear it. And then we're doing a tour with ICW, it's myself and DCT are doing ring crew. And we got the ring away and we're backstage. And I think it was Grado's birthday at the time. And they wanted me to do a promo for Grado as Steve Austin. So I'd done a wee bit, happy birthday, your son of a bitch, and all that kind of stuff. And funnily enough, Finn Balor, Fergal, was backstage. And I'd done one as Austin against Finn Balor, saying you're stepping into my town and all that kind of stuff. And has Dallas heard this? I'm like, no, I don't think so. I was like, hold on a minute, hold on. So that Dallas get brought in, like, hot. He couldn't see nothing, and then I promoed, and Dallas like, who is that? Who the f- is that? And he's like, how did you know to tell me you could do that? You're booked. I was like, what? He said, we're using that. So I spoke with Dallas a wee bit more, and we decided to run with it on the ABC Church House Party. We ran through, we were trying to figure out how we could turn that into a gimmick somehow, and we thought about the concussion angle. And during that show, I get hit in the head with a chair from Chris Renfrew. I get taken backstage, out cold. And then when Dallas was doing an announcement for the Barras, I think, I swagger out in a pair of jeans, shaved head and a leather waistcoat. And we go through the whole, you're injured spiel, we ends up taking a stunner and for there just kind of shot off. I mean, it was the one character I used that never wrestled that made money. It was ridiculous.
It was everywhere for a period. I mean, you obviously had the wit t-shirts, you had the arrive, stun, leave shirt and all that kind of stuff. But you're also, then you're put with Joe Hendry around about the same time. So,
that was a good thing. So the whole thing with me and Joe, for my recollection, was this was on the third Spaceballs, I believe, that they didn't have anything for me. They didn't know what to do. There's only so much I can go out and interrupt somebody and stun them, and then that's it. Because, in all honesty, could I have done a match as Stone Cold with that amount of tenacity and aggression? Probably not. It made it look great. Rumble spots, yeah. Battle royal spots, yeah. Occasional stunner spot, yeah. But then we need to do something. So I was backstage and was told, go get the camera person or whatever and go film some promos. So I ended up grabbing somebody's guitar from the crowd or something. I was walking about doing Austin's guitar gig and I ended up grabbing Red Lightning at one point, some lady in red to him, and I ended up bumping into Joe, who had the idea for a song. And it just went from there, and it just shot off. Like, doing the promos and doing the entrance videos with Joe were absolutely great. And it was giving another dynamic to the character. It was almost in a way getting rid of the Stone Cold character into a different Bobby Roberts. Because at points I wasn't even doing the gimmick. I remember doing, well, I think it was like the next episode, the rip, and I came out wearing a black t-shirt, a pair of combats and a jacket. At one point it was Fred Durst. It was a good way to get rid of the Stone Cold character without getting rid of it, if you know what I mean.
Of course, because you did the Phil Collins drum solo. I remember that one.
Oh my God, that was that was a year after I debuted the Steve Austin, the Austin gimmick, sorry, and I'm like, what am I doing? You want me to do what? Oh, right, so I'm the monkey, right, okay. And I'm thinking to myself, John, I'm meant to be wrestling, I'm a wrestler, this is just ridiculous. And then when I actually do it and then watch it back, going, no, I'm an entertainer. That's what made the difference. The whole crowd popped. As soon as I held up the gorilla mask and look at the drum kit, the crowd popped and it made sense there and then. It was great. And the way Billy Kirkwood sold it on commentary was brilliant.
Another one I remember is Philadelphia.
She's a Philadelphia.
Yeah.
That was such a weird one to film, by the way, because we had to do it in like Socky Hall Street. And there were so many people watching me. And like I've never seen the film Philadelphia. I know what it's about. So I'm playing Tom Hanks in this. I'm like, okay, so why? And then when he explained the video to me and what it was for, I was like, right, okay, I still don't know what I'm doing. He's like, no, just go with it, we'll be fine. And I'm like, all right, okay. Okay, to this day, it makes no sense. Like, apart from he just wants something decent in his burger, that's it.
I'll be honest, I've never seen Philadelphia either, so I'm very confused by the video, but it still makes me laugh. So, it's done its job.
Why am I skipping in Socky Hall Street wearing a bonnet and an old man's jacket? And I'm in shock. I was on my way to training at that point. I'm like, I don't know what's going on.
So you mentioned, moves on greatly to our two stupid questions I ask, but you mentioned you were a butcher, so you'll, yes, you'll have some theories on this. What would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
A cow.
Just straight up.
Just a cow? You ever punched a cow? I have. Trust me, their heads are solid. Just like a sheep is going to do nothing. It's just too small. Can't do anything. Can't reach a cow's head. It can barely reach a cow's udders if you're lucky. And it'll just gone. Big ball of fluff, gone. A cow's a cow.
I'm still believing in the two sheep, but yeah, a cow is starting to move ahead. Move ahead. There we go.
Summer Scotty Rennick just smiled because he heard a pun.
Oh, I remember being on a show at Dundee, Scott, backstage, and Scott Rennick was on it, and honestly, I don't think I ever heard a sentence that didn't have a pun come out of his mouth the whole time. I was there for 4 hours.
If you look up the word dad jokes in the dictionary, there's a picture of Scott Rennick right next to it.
And our other stupid question is, of course, what's your favourite dinosaur?
T-Rex.
That's a classic.
T-Rex, straight away, because you look at the story arc of Jurassic Park, right the way to Jurassic World and Fallen Kingdom, it's the same T-Rex all the way. And just, funnily enough, I would show you my ringtone, but I'm using the camera. My ringtone is actually the Jurassic, the T-Rex roar from Jurassic Park. Right. And I crap myself every time it goes off because I forget it's there.
Definitely not the same way, but mine's the Marvel opening. And I genuinely, because I'm a child, I get so excited when someone phones me. And then I realise I have to answer the phone.
Well, funnily enough, that's my message tone. My ringtone is actually the theme tune to Red Dwarf.
But yeah, I'm just I don't know why. I think I'll be conditioned by Marvel now to be so excited when I hear that bit, and I'm just like, oh, what's happening? Oh, someone's phoning me.
It's a phone call. Yes. No, I haven't been in a car accident in the last 5 years.
Oh, yeah. It's like, oh, your Amazon order is arriving. It's like, I didn't order anything. Leave me alone. right. So we'll move on to Twitch.
Okay.
With Ruby. I think I've pretty much ticked off all my notes on my way, so I can throw in my pen. So during lockdown, of course, nothing's happening. Nothing happened at all. And you started doing Twitch with Ruby. She obviously said how it was all set up, but from your side of things, how did you go about
it? I'll not lie to you, it's like one of those, oh, there's a good coattail, I'm going to jump on that. And I'd seen, like, obviously Emily Hayden doing it, and it's a good laugh, and like obviously Jayla Dark and a few others playing games, and I love playing games, but I'm awful at them, and I get frustrated and annoyed. So I was like, people would like to see that. People would like to see me getting visibly frustrated and upset. Would they pay money for it? Maybe. I'm 8 followers away from 100, which is good, and I'm already affiliated, which is even better. And I've made a whole $33, which I don't see at all at 100. But it gives me something to do. Like, I get to talk to people, I get to interact with people, and bring a wee bit of happiness to them. I don't know if you've seen it, but when we done the Horrible Foods episode, where we basically made up mystery boxes. So if we got a follow or we die, or eventually we just give up and just feed each other things. It was one of the highest episodes we'd ever done. And knowing people were getting a good laugh out of that made me happy, and it kept me going. We haven't done ones recently, like obviously due to my dip in health, and the same with Ruby. Well, hopefully we were going to do one tonight, but I've got other plans, unfortunately. Next week, I think we're doing one, and we're bringing in a TENS machine, which is like the ab thing you put on and then you shock it.
Oh, okay.
So we're going to be doing that. And plus, I asked Ruby along to do it as well, because it helps her be herself in front of a crowd. Even though she can't see the crowd, people are still watching, and she gets that kind of practice on screen, because you never know when it's going to be needed, to be fair. And plus, she frustrates the hell out of me when it comes to games, like to the point of sheer disappointment. That we were stuck on a level of Mario for 3 weeks. I think we actually lost some viewers because of that.
I was the exact same. I tried to do the Twitch thing. Well, mainly I made a load of wrestling characters and what have you, and then half of them had to delete, so that it stopped being fun for me. But I was the same. I started playing and I thought, no, I'm a terrible loser, and I'm not very good at games. This is not a combination I want people to see in my life. I would rather them just
Ideally, I would like to do it with like my PlayStation 4 and obviously Modern Warfare. I think I'm going to be doing, once we can, me and Emily Hayden are going to be doing one together where we're playing Rayman. Because a wee while back when the world was normal, she was down at mine and we're playing Rayman, and I was getting severely frustrated in her playing ability for that game. And I'm like, this could work on camera. It would work really well because we've got quite good chemistry. And then I'm thinking, like, my mate who watches me simply Modern Warfare all the time, I'm so gung-ho, I just literally run around a corner and into fire for some strange reason, and he thinks it's hilarious, so he thinks that might work on, like, on video as well. I'm like, all right, cool, something we could try. Just, I need to sort out, obviously, the equipment side of things more than anything else. Right now I'm just using emulators and they're easy enough, but I think once you step on more expensive hardware, things kind of go a wee bit south.
Well, at least with the PS4 you can do it straight from the PS4.
The remote play, I think that's the best option I've got.
that was why I gave up. But what you're saying, the confidence and having Ruby doing the in front of a camera, it's certainly this last year especially, it's shown who's willing to do that, who's willing to put that little bit extra effort in, because there's no shows, can't train, I put we. You guys can't train. I wasn't doing training beforehand. But we're finding ways to put personalities out. That's why I did the podcast, because it gives people like Benny, or it gives trainees, Sean Martin coming up, a chance to at least tell their stories.
It's an extra platform. It's easy enough doing a spoken word podcast because you can't see anybody. But like, I know that when this goes out, people will watch me, they'll see my reactions, they'll see how I react to questions. And like, if I'm in gimmick or not, they would know the difference, if that makes sense. So doing like this kind of visual podcast, it bodes well for a lot of people coming out the gate just now, especially guys. There's a lot of guys that haven't had matches yet, but they're putting their characters over first, which is great, it's brilliant. But my only worry is they're putting over such a strong character. Is their ability going to match up with that character, or at least match up to what they're putting out?
I could not agree more. I mean, I'm loving seeing these promos and creativity, but yeah you're building up a high expectation that it'll be very difficult to actually...
I mean, don't get me wrong, me saying that will ruffle a lot of feathers, and to be fair, most of the time, whose feather have I not ruffled, to be fair? But at the same time, I've been getting CVs for respect for when we get shows come back and are talking about this, that and the other, and I'm like, how many matches have you had? None. Well, what can I do? But at the same time, these are the same people that are coming out of really, really good schools. Obviously, there's a lot for Joe Hendry's school, there's a lot for FPWA, and they're absolutely fantastic. And I know some of them personally as well, so, and especially the calibre of the coaching, I've got no doubt they're going to be great.
Yeah, like I said, I'm not in any disagreement with you. At first, I was like, oh, this is a bit strange. I would like to see some wrestling first, but it's doing that. You're not saying it they shouldn't be doing it kind of way. You're putting a bit of logic towards it, going, it's great you're doing it, but you're building up an expectation for yourself that it's going to be difficult to go with. So I don't think, I think feathers, if there's any feathers, I can't say the word, feathers ruffled in that respect, they're aiming to ruffle them in the first place for you. So I can't see anything wrong with what you're saying there. I was going to ask you, of course, to maybe do a bit of a Stone Cold depression, but you've got hay fever, and as someone who has that, I'm not expecting you to do it. So,
but if you want to go for it. Bottom line is, Billy Strachan, let me tell you something, son. You got me on your podcast talking about who knows what, when knows what. The bottom line is, respect pro wrestling. Pro Wrestling Center comes back on the 17th of May. Get your ass in the ring, and that's the bottom line.
I think there's no better way to finish up the show then. Where can people find you on social media? Where's Respect Pro Wrestling? Where can people find you?
That will come out so bad, by the way. It was the worst thing to record as like an audio clip. So many takes, trying to do one small promo, trying to get it right, because the rasp in the voice and the audio is just ridiculous.
So that's the bit I'm going to clip. If I do get around to start clipping bits out to put out to promo, that's the one that's going out anyway. I've got Joe Hendry doing a Trump impression for a second. I'm like, that's it. That's the one that's going. But yeah, where can people find you on social media?
So you can follow us. You can obviously see us on Facebook under Respect Pro Wrestling, on Twitter, Respect Pro Wrest 1. You'll get us on TikTok as well, but that's under this guy, Bobby Roberts. Instagram on Respect Pro Wrestling as well. So we're hopefully going to be opening up the Respect Pro Training Centre again on the 17th of May, hopefully. So we'll have roughly 5 classes a week. We're also going to be starting up a brand new wrestling boot camp for people that don't want to actually wrestle but want to do all the fitness aspects, because as wrestlers we have to have some sort of fitness behind us, hence maybe. So we're looking to try that out as well, and our kids' classes will be starting back up quite soon.
Perfect. Well, thank you for joining me today.
No problem, Billy. Thanks very much.